All right, ANP1 students, this video we're going to continue talking about homeostasis, and now we're moving on to the learning objectives that cover the two different categories or types of homeostatic control systems. So this little cartoon shows the two types. There's a type category called positive feedback and then negative feedback. So we'll come back to this picture and talk about that. So we're down here to the objectives 14 through 17, talking about the difference between negative feedback homeostatic control systems and then positive feedback homeostatic control systems. All right, we're going to run to our book here. And what we're going to, I'm going to actually slide that down a little bit so we can see our little picture down here. I think that's as much as I could do. Okay, so this that I have highlighted, if we have a homeostatic control system that's considered negative feedback, what that means is whatever action or response that the effectors are going to cause, it is going to move the parameter in the opposite direction of what the stimulus was, or what, and remember, stimulus is the change that happens in the body. So for example, if we are talking about body temperature, so if we have a stimulus or a change that causes our body temperature to rise above the set point, then what our negative feedback homeostatic control system is going to do is move that parameter in the opposite direction of what the change was. So if the change is to increase the body temperature, then the resulting response or action of the effectors is going to decrease that temperature. So I think that's kind of why they gave it the name negative feedback, because it's moving, they're moving in opposite directions. So the stimulus or change is an increasing in temperature, then the result effect of the effectors, the response, is going to be a decrease in the temperature. So that is the kind of explanation of what a negative feedback homeostatic control system, how it works. So, and because it works in this way, it keeps that parameter or variable within a normal range or at a set point. So this down here kind of gives you a graphic representation of this. So let's say the variable is body temperature. So this line, so this is all body temperature. So down here would be like 30 degrees Fahrenheit, up here to be like 100 degrees Fahrenheit. So we want, you know, our set point is 98.6 degrees. So throughout the day, what will happen is, so we'll say this is first thing in the morning, our body temperature may start to rise. And with a negative feedback mechanism, which this is an example of one with body temperature homeostasis, that increase, that change in the temperature, is going to activate this negative feedback control system to cause the body temperature to go back down, go in the opposite direction. And then if it gets too low, the response or action is going to cause it to go higher. And again, we're trying to keep this little green line showing the body temperature fluctuations throughout the day. So, but what you're negative feedback homeostatic control system is trying to do is to keep it around that set point or in this normal range. Those little dashed lines there showing, like, you know, any temperature in this normal range is sufficient for normal body processes. But it will, it's not always, our body temperature doesn't stay at 98.6 all day long, you know, right there. We don't, it's not regulated that strictly. So it's going to fluctuate, but again, we'll just keep moving it towards set point. So hopefully that's a good, hopefully that explained negative feedback. And this is going to be the most abundant type of homeostatic control system. Most of our parameters or variables in the body, like body temperature, blood pressure, heart rate, respiratory rate, the sugar in our blood, the calcium in our blood, is regulated with negative feedback. So we have a set point for all those, and the homeostatic control system, if it's negative feedback, is going to try to keep that variable or parameter near that set point. So whatever the stimulus is or change, the response of that homeostatic control system is going to cause it to go in the opposite direction. So that's why they call it negative feedback. Okay, so hopefully that's clear. So then we're going to talk about, let me go back to the objectives here. So define negative feedback. So what you could use for your definition of that, sorry, I'm in the wrong place. It's a homeostatic control system that is going to cause the response or effect to move in the opposite direction of whatever the stimulus or change is. And again, you can add that it keeps that parameter at a certain set point because it does that. All right, and then some examples was also in there. Give examples of body processes regulated. So we talked about body temperature, sugar in the blood, calcium, heart rate, respiratory rate, blood pressure, all those. So pretty much like, 95% of the body processes are gonna be like, controlled by a negative feedback control system. So, okay. And then this says, explain how the homeostatic mechanisms regulated by negative feedback detect and respond to environmental changes. So again, we're just talking about how that negative feedback mechanism works. So we talked about that in that little, the little picture here. So just talking about how it can keep that parameter variable. It fluctuates, but it keeps it pretty close to the set point or in that normal range. So, all right. And then for positive feedback. So this is the process homeostatic control system that is less common in the body. And what it's going to do is instead of moving a parameter or variable back towards set point, like in the opposite direction, with positive feedback mechanism, whatever the stimulus is or change, the response or effect is going to move it in the same direction. So that's why I call it positive, because it's moving in the same direction. And I'll show you, I think they also had a picture of that. Yeah. So here is the picture. So I'm going to go ahead and talk to you about some examples, so then we can kind of apply it to this graph. So let's think about when a woman is in labor. So we'll say the variable is the contractions of the uterus, because those are necessary to have the baby. So, and this is over time. So in this case, this process in the body, it's controlled by homeostasis. But it's not intended to keep something at a set point. Its main goal is to reach a climactic event. So if it's a woman that's in labor, the climactic event is going to be the birth of the child. So in this case, whatever the stimulus is or change, and usually we'll get into that later in ANP2, but usually we have some hormones and some stretching going on that's going to cause the uterine muscles to contract. And that'll send a signal to the woman's nervous system, the brain. And that's the control center. And then what the brain does is comes back and tells the effectors, which is the muscle in the uterus, to contract even more. So in that case, the stretching and the hormones cause the uterus muscles to contract, and those little receptors sent that signal up to the brain. And so then the brain sends a signal down, not to stop them from contracting, but to cause them to contract more. So the change is contraction of the uterine muscles, and then the response is going to be more contraction of the uterine muscles. And that little positive feedback loop will continue until the birth of the baby. And then once the baby's born, then that positive feedback, stops. And so you don't have any more uterine contractions, or at least a lot less starts to drop. So, okay. And I use the example of a woman in labor where this example that they used for positive feedback. This is another example that you should be familiar with. So a woman in labor is one example of where positive feedback control system is at work. Another one is whenever a woman is nursing her infant. So same kind of thing, the whatever the stimulus is. So baby suckling the milk is going to cause the milk to be released from the mammary glands. And then what happens is the control center gets that information, and then it goes down and causes the effect of more milk being released. And so as long as we have the stimulus of the milk wanting to be released, then the effect's going to be more milk being released. And that'll continue until the baby stops stimulating the mammary glands, and then that. So the climactic event is, you know, the feeding of the infant. And so once that feeding is finished, then that loop is stopped until the next feeding. So that's another example. So a woman in labor, a woman nursing her child. And then the other example, I kind of put it down here, blood clotting is another example of the positive feedback mechanism. So in order for us, if we get like a cut in one of our blood vessels, we have a hole in it. And so our bodies need to make a plug to seal that hole off so no more blood can leave it. So the change is going to be the hole in the blood vessel wall. And then we're going to get, when that happens, platelets stick to that area. That'll send a signal out, usually through hormones, to the body. And then instead of like saying, oh, no more platelets stick, it says, more platelets, please stick, more platelets, please stick. And that loop will keep going until we get like a nice platelet plug and we don't have any more. We have we've sealed that hole in the blood vessel wall, so no more blood can leave. And then that process will stop. So the climactic event is like once the formation of the platelet plug happens and seals off that hole in the vessel, blood vessel, then it will stop. So those are our three examples of positive feedback. And those are the three there's other ones, but those are the three that you should be familiar with. Okay, so to finish up, I'm gonna go back to our little cartoon here so you can see and maybe understand this cartoon a little bit better. So positive feedback, what we're gonna have is whatever the stimulus or change is, the response or effect is gonna be more of that same change or stimulus. And then for the negative feedback, what we're gonna have is whatever the stimulus or change is, we want to counteract, or we want to do the opposite of what that change is going to be. So we will have an opposite direction of our parameter variable in that case. So, all right, so that ends our video for homeostasis and the difference between positive feedback control systems and negative feedback control systems. So those are two types of homeostatic control systems. All right, I'll see you in the next video.